Hi, welcome to Nursing School Explained. Today's topic is hydrocephalus. So let's take a look here. So hydrocephalus is an imbalanced production and absorption of cerebrospinal fluid. And remember that cerebrospinal fluid is in the brain and also flows all the way down into the spinal cord. And it's usually contained within the ventricles of the brain, but when there's too much cerebrospinal fluid, the ventricles inside the brain will dilate. And when that happens, the brain gets compressed. And I wrote down here these three terms. So basically, in our cranial cavity, we have three components. We have the brain, we have blood inside the blood vessels, and we have cerebrospinal fluid. And usually that's all contained in our skull. So this is a nice protective mechanism to protect the brain, blood, and cerebrospinal fluid. But when there's now increased production of cerebrospinal fluid, there's an imbalance between these three structures or compartments within the brain. And so then something has to give. And if the cerebrospinal fluid gets larger and larger, the brain gets compressed against the skull. Now, hydrocephalus is usually something that occurs in infants or children. And the good thing about infants is that their skull is not completely fused yet. So they have their anterior and posterior fontanelles open still. And so when the cerebrospinal fluid, there's an increased production, then it has the skull, there's basically room for that to expand. And so then you will see fontanelles that are bulging because now the cerebrospinal fluid is causing increased intracranial pressure, and these fontanelles will kind of allow the expansion of the cerebrospinal fluid. So when there's open fontanelles, then the skull will basically enlarge. You will see the bulging fontanelles, but then over time, because the skull, the bones of the skull are still kind of formable, pliable, it will result in hydrocephalus. So their skull cavity, their whole head will get bigger. Now that's the advantage of having open fontanelles, but if the fontanelles are closed, there's no way for the skull to expand. Everything is already set, and then the patient will exhibit signs and symptoms of increased intracranial pressure, which will be all kinds of neurological signs. So what causes hydrocephalus? It's either congenital, so that can be either by tumors that are causing increased cerebrospinal fluid production, or Chiari malformation. And Chiari malformation is a complication of spina bifida cystica or myelomeningocele, which is a neural tube defect. And keep in mind that in embryonic development, the embryo is basically just a tube that eventually starts to develop and elongate and develop into the different parts. And this neural tube can have a defect called spina bifida or myelomeningocele, where there is then at the level of L5-S1, kind of like a sac-like protrusion. And if this protrusion happens, the brain kind of gets sucked down into the spinal cord, and this is called a Chiari malformation. And in turn, cerebrospinal fluid will increase, causing the increased pressure in the cranial cavity and then the enlargement of the skull with all those complications. Now, another cause is acquired hydrocephalus, and this might be due to neonatal meningitis as well as subarachnoid hemorrhage, so bleeding in that intracranial cavity. So in this case, the cause would be the actual blood taking up more space here rather than the cerebrospinal fluid, but nonetheless, the cerebral cavity will expand. Now, how do we diagnose this? That's why we measure head circumference in infants at every visit. And sometimes it's pretty obvious already if the patient has spina bifida that is detected during the prenatal checkups or some other abnormalities that occur. But head circumference is number one. And then certainly a CAT scan or MRI to help get some pictures of the exact structures of the brain, to see what might be causing it. Or an ultrasound can also be helpful, an transcranial ultrasound, as well as a lumbar puncture, which will help to detect the subarachnoid hemorrhage. Now, the treatment goal for hydrocephalus is to decrease that CSF accumulation so that the skull cavity doesn't get enlarged, which helps to decrease disability and death. And the way this is accomplished is by the ventricular peritoneal shunt, or also called a VP shunt. And bear with me here, I'm not the greatest drawer there is, but I drew out our child here. And the VP shunt basically means there's a tube placed inside the ventricle of the brain that's then threaded down through one of the blood vessels of the neck all the way down into the abdomen, and basically the contents are just emptied into the abdominal cavity, within the body just reabsorbs that CSF, allowing it to drain and not accumulate in the brain. And that's usually done in smaller children. If children need a shunt for hydrocephalus and they're a little bit older, this might be a ventricular atrial shunt. So basically, again, stemming from the ventricles of the brain, and that shunt now ends up inside the right atrium, where the CSF just enters the brain, the bloodstream, and then is circulated throughout the blood and then reabsorbed by the body. Now, as you can imagine, any time you have a surgical procedure that involves placing a shunt inside the brain, there's a high risk for infection. So complications of either one of these shunts are infection or blockage. And keep in mind, these shunts are usually there for a lifetime. So you might even see adults that have a VP shunt or VA shunt implanted, and now they are maybe brought to the hospital for altered level of consciousness, and then your thought should be maybe there's a blockage or an infection of that shunt, and if the shunt is now blocked, that CSF again is accumulating, causing the brain to be compressed, causing altered level of consciousness and neurological deficits. And the shunt also might need to be changed, which means that there's a surgical procedure involved, and again, whenever we have a surgical procedure involved in the central nervous system, we always have to be concerned about infection. So thank you for watching this video on hydrocephalus. If you would like more information on spina bifida, there's a separate video about that. Thanks for watching Nursing School Explained.